Hi, I'm Dr. Bruce Callen, the chair of the physics department here at Drury University. I'd like to extend my welcome to you as you begin your online studies in Physics 290, Space Missions, taught by Mr. Jim Caffey. I hope that your semester is an enjoyable and a productive one, and I invite you to consider returning to take more classes with us here at Drury.
Hello, and welcome to the DVD companion to this course, Space Missions, Physics 290, online at Drury University. This DVD will be the only component to the course besides the online component. There is no book to this course, so you will need this DVD to complete this course. During this intense 8-week course on space missions, robotic and unmanned, we will discuss everything from the moon to other moons, planets, and the solar system and beyond, including the Hubble Space Telescope. We'll take some virtual field trips out to various sites around the Ozarks that are of historical interest, including the birthplace of Edwin Hubble, where there is a replica of the Hubble Space Telescope. By now you should know who I am. I'm Jim Caffey, your instructor for this course. I wrote this course up especially for Drury, and I'm also a NASA Solar System Ambassador. What that basically means is I go around Southwest Missouri, the state of Missouri, and around the nation giving special talks and listening to lectures about NASA, its missions, and the space program, and talking to school-age children and civic groups about NASA and its space missions. In some former capacity, I've been affiliated with NASA for now for about 15 years, either as an educator, volunteer, or researcher. During this 8-week course, we will learn all about different space missions, robotic and unmanned. In this 290 course, you will do various discussions and homework questions in my lecture area. You will turn those into the email section. I hope you find this DVD very interesting. I put a lot of work into it in developing the studio here at Drury University to compile this DVD just for you. I hope you really enjoy it. Let's get started with the components of this DVD. Welcome to the first lesson. During this lesson, we will learn about missions that were unmanned and sent to the moon. These are precursors to the manned missions that were sent to the moon. Ranger and Surveyor missions all had different objectives. Some were sent to go orbiting the moon, some were sent to crash into the moon, and some soft landed into the moon. In 1976, we landed on Mars with the Viking missions. We also orbited with the twin orbiters around Mars. The Viking missions were trying to map the surface of Mars and at the same time look for biological life on Mars for the first time with little scoops that would look into the soil and look for biological life. However, they found no conclusive evidence for life on Mars through the two exclusive samples they looked for in the two sample sites that they found. Now, does this mean that there was never any life on Mars? Not necessarily. And this is because if you were to go on Earth and look at two particularly general regions on Earth and look for life and didn't happen to find any, does that mean that there's not any life on Earth? No, not necessarily. You just didn't find any right there in those two areas. Maybe you looked at the two wrong spots. That's what happened with the Viking missions, Viking 1 and Viking 2. The Magellan mission was a mapping mission to peer through the very dense and thick clouds layer of Venus. Now, the Soviets had landed on Venus several times and took several pictures to say, "Hello, we're here." And they quickly burned up because of the intense heat and pressure on Venus. Their missions didn't last very long. The United States didn't use that approach. We learned that through radar mapping, we could pierce through the cloud layer and map the surface of Venus. We did that very successfully and got many, many pictures of Venus's surface. In fact, we have a better map of Venus's surface than we do of Earth's own entire surface. Why is that? It's mainly because Earth is covered by three-fourths water, and it's hard to map the ocean surface because of all that water. And for that reason, we have a better map of Venus's surface, even though it's got a very thick cloud layer, than we do of Earth's surface, thanks to Magellan. The Galileo spacecraft was launched out of the space shuttle cargo bay and sent on to Jupiter. Now, it didn't take a straight path to Jupiter, as you'll see in my lecture notes. It went kind of a roundabout way of getting around to Jupiter. In getting to Jupiter, it noticed and saw the first collision ever seen in space by comet Shoemaker-Levy 9. This comet impacted Jupiter in 1994 in about 2 dozen pieces, about 1 kilometer in size, each. This collision was seen in July of 94 by the Galileo spacecraft and by amateur and professional astronomers all around the world. It was such a wild impact, series of impacts, that it crashed the JPL computers here on Earth because so many visitors was trying to view it. In fact, so many visitors tried to view it that I think in one day they said they had 600,000 visitors to one site, and that crashed the servers back in 1994. Today, they can have 600 million visitors to one site and not have many problems. It's amazing how technology has advanced. The Galileo spacecraft visited Jupiter and its Galilean moons. Io, Fire, Europa, covered with ice and maybe a salty ocean underneath, Ganymede, and Callisto. And there are probably about 63 or more moons beyond that. Jupiter is the most massive planet in the solar system, and it probably has the most moons in the solar system. And you could put all the planets in the solar system in the inside of Jupiter and still have room left over. It is the most massive planet in the solar system. Now, sometimes people call Jupiter a failed star, and that would be an incorrect statement. Jupiter is far, far from a failed star, so don't get that confused. You may have seen that in a science class somewhere. It's not true. Jupiter's mass is far from a failed star. It's just a large planet. In fact, astronomers have found planets outside of our solar system many times more massive and many times bigger than Jupiter itself. And they are still far away from a failed star. Mars Pathfinder was the first rover and lander system to ever land on another planet. And in just a minute, I'll show you a picture of that system that was on the planet Mars on its first day of landing, July 4th, 1997. The lander was named Carl Sagan Memorial Lander System in honor of Carl Sagan. The rover was called Sojourner. The Sojourner rover was about the size of a small camera bag that you would put a video camera in, or maybe as the size of a small space heater. It didn't return very much science, but what it did do is demonstrate the technologies used for what we will study later on in the class, and that will be the Mars Exploration Rovers Spirit and Opportunity. So this week we're talking about Mars failed missions, and I have a picture here, a globe here of a little image of Mars, and this is a destination we want to go to. Mars is a very hard place to go to, even though it's the next planet out from Earth. Over half of all the Mars missions we've sent out, and this is the planet we've sent the most missions to, have failed. This is because it's very hard to get to. It has an atmosphere to it, even though it's thin. And a lot of missions burn up or just don't get the right trajectory to get there. Now, three of the Mars missions that failed were the Mars Observer, the Mars Climate Orbiter, and the Mars Polar Lander. Let's talk about these three missions in general and in particular one by one. In one hand here I have a large blown up Mars beach ball. I like to use this on sunny days with kids and in pools. And on the other hand, I have a Mars globe that I got when I went to a Mars mission launch that I'll talk about later on in the class. But it's very hard to get to Mars. The first mission that we'll talk about that failed was the Mars Observer. This mission almost got to Mars. It got very close to Mars. The Mars Observer mission was a very expensive mission. It was a $1 billion mission. Let's repeat that again. A billion with a B dollar mission. It was one of the NASA's biggest missions ever sent out. It was a big mission with lots of big instruments, and it was going to do everything NASA ever wanted to do back in the early 90s. However, they think what happened with it was that some kind of fuel line on it split open or had a fuel leak right as it started to insert itself into orbit around the planet Mars, and it spun out of control. What happened after that is speculation. Maybe it crash landed on Mars. Maybe it went out into space somewhere and is still going out somewhere. We don't know. But it didn't make it to Mars. The second mission that failed was the Mars Polar Lander. Mars Polar Lander, we think, actually made it to Mars right here at the South Pole. The South Pole of Mars has an ice cap on it. And this ice cap is very neat because it comes and goes. It retracts and comes and goes as the seasons on Mars changes. And NASA and scientists wanted to see how the impact of the rocks comes and goes and how that changes with the seasons. What they think happened, and this is still a speculation, is that one of the landing gears or landing pads, the struts, kind of like the struts on a tripod, didn't deploy correctly. And as the lander landed down on to the South Pole, it literally fell over. That's one opinion. The other opinion was that as it started to land onto the South Pole of Mars, its laser-guided altimeter failed to recognize how high it was, shut off its engines, and literally went splat right onto Mars and fell. There is a mission going on right now that we'll talk about near the end of the class that we'll actually be able to see objects the size of this beach ball and should be able to find the Mars polar lander. Now, the Mars climate orbiter was just a big goof up. The Mars climate orbiter was a case of mixed up units. If you've ever taken a math class or a physics class, either in high school, maybe even middle school, or in college, you know that, or hopefully you know that, or should know that, at the end of a number, you have units. If you're driving down the highway, you sometimes will say, I'm going 70 down the interstate. But 70 what? 70 kilometers per hour or 70 miles per hour? You have to have that unit down after the number to really mean what you're saying. Well, the people who built the Mars Climate Orbiter and the people who programmed the Mars Climate Orbiter mixed up the units. One group said one thing and one group said another thing. And so, when the probe went into orbit around Mars, it got to Mars, but when it got into orbit around Mars, instead of doing a nice orbital insertion around Mars, we think it did a nosedive into the atmosphere and burned up. So what happened? No more Mars mission. That led to some major changes at NASA, and that led to some changes into another mission I'll talk about after we take our midterm, which is coming up in the next section. Welcome back. This part of the class talks about current missions going on. They're either being analyzed or are still going on and getting ready to go on to other parts of the solar system and beyond. The first two are Deep Impact and the Voyager missions, which are still being analyzed and have already completed their part of the main missions. Deep Impact went to a comet on July 4th, 2005. Deep Impact was a mission that went to Comet Tempel 1, and the comet actually overtook the impactor of the spacecraft and slammed into it at an amazing speed of 23,000 miles per hour. At first, it was estimated that it would create a crater on the comet the size of the Rose Bowl Stadium or a football field. Well, in the pictures you're going to see in the online part of the course, and the pictures you'll see on the websites, you'll see that they may not have even figured out how big the crater was. They were hoping that on the day after, in the day of the impact, they would know exactly how big the crater was. Well, there was so much data, and so much enthusiasm, and so much enjoyment of what was going on, so much data came back that they did not have any clue how big the crater was, because so much data came back they were overwhelmed by everything that was coming back. And 6 months later they still had no clue how much material came out of the comet, except they did learn a few things about the comet. Comets used to be known as dirty snowballs. Some may still be, but this particular comet is more of a talcum powder comet. Material blown out by it was just blown out in bits and pieces like baby powder. So you'll see that in the pictures that you'll see online. Go to that website and take a look at the amazing pictures of Comet Tempel 1 being hit by Deep Impact.
T-minus 15, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. We have ignition and liftoff of a Delta II rocket carrying deep impact. NASA's journey to unlock the mystery of the solar system's origin.
Up on T plus 36 seconds, we are now supersonic. We're now passing an altitude of 3 miles, downrange distance 13 miles, and coming up on 2,000 miles an hour. First stage performance still looking good, and we have exceeded max Q. All ground start motors have tapered off, and we have reached burnout. And the air starts have ignited, and all 6 ground start motors have jettisoned. See the normal level of disturbance after solid motor jettison, and that has damped out nicely. We're now passing T plus 86 seconds into the mission. Air start solid motors all burning symmetrically, and they've passed their peak chamber pressure, coming up on T plus 105 seconds. Stage system still looking good. Now passing an altitude of 19 miles, downrange distance 45, and a velocity of over 4,000 miles an hour. Main engine and verniers continue to burn well, good chamber pressures there, and we're tapering off, reaching burnout of the air start motors. Jettison. All 3 air start motors have jettisoned. And we have pressurized the LOX tank. We have reset the relief reset. We can confirm a slow increase in LOX tank pressure, now passing T plus 150 seconds. First stage performance still looks good. Main engine and verniers still burning well. Nice good chamber pressure there.
Everything continues to look good with the deep impact payload on board. The 9 solid rocket strap-on boosters have been jettisoned, and the deep impact spacecraft is on its way to catch up to Temple 1 in July. We are now hearing Boeing's Mark Levine in the NASA telemetry lab, where real-time telemetry from the vehicle is coming in from the downrange tracking stations.
The Voyager missions was a grand tour of the outer solar system. This mission is still going on. Its extended mission now is to look for the outer portion of the extent of the sun's reach. What does that mean? How far out does the sun's radiation reach out into the outer solar system? how many astronomical units does it go out to? And we think now that it's starting to reach a critical point in the solar system called the heliopause, where the sun's influence stops and it reaches a shock wave. You'll learn about that in the online part of the course. I hope you enjoy this part of the session, and welcome back after the break.
Two Voyager spacecraft were launched in 1977 on a journey to the outer giant outer planets, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. Voyager 2 flew by Neptune in 1989, and from then on, the two spacecraft were on their interstellar mission headed to the edge of interstellar space. The Voyager spacecraft will be humanity's first interstellar probes. They will be the first to go outside the region that's filled with material from our own star, and the first steps into interstellar space. Voyager 1 has reached a historic milestone. It has crossed outside of the supersonic solar wind, across what we call the termination shock, into a slow wind area, which we call the heliosheath, where the solar wind is much slower, much thicker, and much hotter than it was just before the shock. Voyager now is almost 100 times as far from the sun as the Earth is, so the sun is very dim, 1/10,000th as bright as it is here at Earth, and of course the planets are just specks of light in the great distance as Voyager drifts ever further into space. We listen to the two Voyager spacecraft every day because they're measuring the magnetic fields in the solar wind, they're measuring the wind itself, how fast it's moving on Voyager 2, they're measuring the energetic particles, the fast ions which are in the outer solar system, and they're measuring the waves in the wind itself, the plasma waves. The termination shock is a source of energetic electrons which stream along the magnetic field and cause the plasma, the solar wind itself, to oscillate. And that can be picked up right in the audio range where, in fact, the stream of electrons are telling us that we're getting very close to the shock. Voyager 1 will reach the edge of interstellar space in about 10 years. Voyager 2 it will likely find the shock perhaps in another 3 years, and then it will take it another 10 years to go through the heliosheath to reach interstellar space. We're very fortunate that the power supply on the spacecraft are radioisotope thermoelectric generators, which will continue powering the two spacecraft until at least the year 2020. It's a very exciting mission to be on because what science is about is learning new things about nature. And when you go places no spacecraft has been before, you're almost bound to learn something that no one knew before.
MGS, or Mars Global Surveyor, has mapped more of the Mars surface in the last decade than any Mars mission ever combined. Mars Odyssey 2001, I will show you some pictures of when I was actually in Cocoa Beach, Florida. I got to see the launch of this mission, and it was an amazing sight. It's the only launch I've ever seen. As the rocket rose up, about 2 seconds later, you heard the roar of it, and it shook the ground. It was pretty amazing. It's looking for radiation around Mars. It's looking for water around Mars underneath the surface, and is looking for the mineral composition around Mars.
It's been a great year, very satisfying year for Mars Odyssey. We completed our primary mission after 2 years, over one full Mars year of mapping. We acquired a tremendous amount of data on the thermal properties, the radiation environment, and the composition of the surface.
We look at the planets to help understand our own and where our place is in the universe and the solar system.
And, you know, we've been tantalized by the fact that life may have arose there. And if it arose, is it still there? And if it's not there, what happened to it? And is there any remains of it?
When you consider all the other billions and billions of stars, there must be other planets out there that aren't too different from Earth. Maybe they do have life on it. Maybe life didn't exist for very long. We don't really know what's going on. Mars, of course, is very close to us and may help us answer some of those philosophical questions that we sometimes just dream about.
I got interested in Mars when I was a kid. My mom bought me a telescope when I was about 12 years old, and I've been looking at Mars ever since. I was fascinated just because it was this tiny little place a long ways away, and people were trying to speculate what it was like. So all my life I've been trying to take better and better pictures and get closer and closer to help sort of imagine what it would be like to actually walk around on that planet.
The camera on Mars Odyssey is called Themis, and it actually is two cameras in one. It's a visible light camera, taking pictures like you would see with your eye, and it's also an infrared camera. So we're able to really learn a lot about the composition of the surface, what minerals make up the surface. It's really a powerful tool, and we've created now two maps, one in the daytime and one in the nighttime, each of which is the highest resolution global map ever acquired at Mars.
Themis is two cameras in one, and we have to actually figure out when to turn them on. So we build a targeting tool called JMARS, and we use it for all of our Themis operations. And right now, our education group has a huge number of K-12 students that use this tool every day for remote learning about Mars. A large number of Mars scientists use it as well because it tends to work for both.
A big part of the Mars program is that we bring current data coming down from Mars to students around the country. The Mars Student Imaging Project allows students from fifth grade all the way up through community college to learn the process of science in a firsthand way. They get to propose a science question. All science begins with a question. Their team gets to pick someplace on Mars that they get to take a picture. We teach them how to use our targeting tool, the real tool that our scientists use. They get to target that image, they get that image back from the spacecraft, they get to do the analysis, and they get to tell NASA what they discovered. The same thing that our scientists are doing, these kids are doing in real time also.
One of the things we really wanted to do on the Odyssey mission is share some of the excitement we have for Mars. And to that end, we created this software, the Themis Image Scroller, and we shipped this out to museums across the country. We have images of every Martian landform imaginable, from canyons to craters to polar ice caps and channels, and we present them all literally only a few days after we've collected them. People can really do science, if you will, at the same time we are doing it.
Often I'm asked, why is it we're interested in studying Mars? And of course, one of the aspects is in comparison to the Earth. Really, in a sense, it's like a laboratory where different processes have been going on, and we can study them to get a better understanding of the processes going on Earth. So originally, we decided to send a gamma ray spectrometer to Mars because it was going to map the different elements as they appear on the surface of the planet, so we could tell where iron was located, silicon, different elements in the periodic table. But one of the most interesting ones that we were hopeful to find would be hydrogen, and that's because hydrogen, of course, is tied up mostly in different forms of water. And water is really an essential building block of life. It turns out, after we got there, we were very surprised. We found far more water than we ever expected. It was all located in the polar region, so it was very cold. It was in the form of ice. And people hadn't seen it before because it was buried just beneath the surface. But the gamma rays can actually, they're somewhat like X-rays, that they can penetrate other material, so we can actually see right through the dust that's on top of it.
The key thing about this data set that's fantastic is that for the first time, we can actually see what's happening, in a sense, in the polar night. All of our other data, has been, visual, and we get limited information about what's going on.
What our data are telling us is that water is in sufficient abundance on Mars, that what we see, which is the upper meter of the surface, which is something like that, contains enough water if you sum over the whole planet to make a layer of water covering the whole planet that's about ankle high. And that seems like a small amount of water, but it's going to pool in places and it can exist below the surface. And if it is below the surface, then there's considerably more water than what we see.
In the future, when we get to the point of human exploration, we're going to have to choose locations where there is water that can be extracted. It's a long way to get to Mars, and there's no possible way to take the quantities of water that you would need for the duration of your visit. It's definitely going to be a driving factor in terms of where human exploration would start.
Well, when people go to Mars or other places in deep space, they're going to be exposed to significantly more radiation than we get here on the surface of the Earth. And so we need to understand exactly what radiation dose people are going to get.
We're using Mars Odyssey to monitor the hazards that astronauts might experience on a trip to Mars.
We got a year and a half worth of good data out of Marie, and we were able to make the determination that the radiation levels were about as expected, 2 to 3 times greater than in Earth orbit. On Earth, we've got a very thick atmosphere, and that stops a great deal of the radiation that comes in. And we've also got a magnetic field, and that causes particles to be deflected towards the poles. If you had the Marie instrument in Earth orbit, and we do, in a sense, because we've got a very similar instrument on the space station, it records levels that are about half as high as what Marie saw.
Radiation Council. Yes. What we're doing here is basically monitoring the radiation environment at the International Space Station. We did it a couple of different ways. We're monitoring output from the sun and then also sort of the natural galactic background. For example, if you look here, you see this green and blue set of lines. This represents a solar event. And if levels reach certain values, then we ask the crew to seek more sheltered areas in the space station, or we can change the timing of what they're going to do and when. Maybe not do an EVA or go outside the vehicle, depending on what's going on. In order to go to Mars to put people on the Martian soil, then all of these kinds of technologies and all of the things that we do here are going to have to be probably expanded significantly and then adapted to that kind of arena.
As we move towards expanding the number of places that we go in the solar system, we'll be going places where the Earthbound satellites don't give us the information we need. So what we'll have to have is a network of monitors all around the solar system so that people can be on the other side of the sun from where Earth is, and we'll still have monitoring capability and warning capability, most importantly, to tell them, yes, a big event is headed your way, you'd better take shelter. I came into working on the Marie project under kind of sad circumstances because Gautam Badwar, who worked in space radiation for his entire distinguished career, unfortunately died shortly after Odyssey was on its way to Mars.
We are sorry we lost Dr. Badwar on the way to Mars. He was a very humble man, and we definitely learned every day. Working with him was a learning experience, and the one thing I remember the most about him is that he always made us feel like equal. He saw Marie function during the cruise phase, but never during orbit, and this is his brainchild, and we were hoping he'd be around to see it, but we have great scientists right now that are working on the team and filling his shoes, and this was truly a team effort between science and engineering and many organizations. It can be used as an example of cooperation between cities, states, and different organizations. A good lesson to learn from and apply on other projects and other tasks.
Having a successful mission like Mars Odyssey requires the efforts of literally hundreds of people A lot of people who you never see behind the scenes are doing just a great job to get the commands up to the spacecraft.
Copy that, thanks.
To do the data handling, to monitor the health of the instruments and all the systems on board.
Data control, RCAs.
These people don't get the credit, but they really deserve it because on our project we have just had a fantastic team. They've done a great job for us, and it's really a tribute to their efforts that we've been so successful. The Odyssey project looks like it's going to be a long-term project, serving the role as landing site scout and now lander relay platform.
The highlight of our operations over the last year really has been our support for Mars exploration rovers. Almost all of the data that's come from the rovers on the surface has come through Odyssey, and we're very proud to have provided that type of support for the rovers.
Our performance to date has been just wonderful, and we believe that the spacecraft will be sort of a cornerstone in the infrastructure of the Mars exploration program for a long, long time.
In the Cassini-Huygens mission, Cassini is an orbiting spacecraft going around Saturn and its rings. The Huygens mission has already happened and dropped a probe down into the thick, hazy atmosphere of Titan, one of the moons of Saturn. It actually was designed to float in a liquid methane or ethane ocean. What it found was that it landed on a kind of a muddy beach on Titan of ethane or methane. It lasted for several hours and returned lots and lots of data back to the Cassini spacecraft. Huygens was a ESA mission, not a NASA part of the mission. It piggybacked on Cassini, which partnered with many nations, such as the European Space Agency, headquartered in Darmstadt, Germany, and the Cassini spacecraft is a multi-billion dollar mission. It's the most expensive, the heaviest, and the most instrumented package ever sent out to the outer solar system. It is a four-year mission costing over $3 billion. But we hope it will return lots of incredible data about Saturn. Dr. Greg Ojikengas, professor of physics, who holds a PhD in planetary science from the California Institute of Technology, otherwise known as Caltech, one of the most highly regarded institutions for planetary science in the world, will speak to us about Saturn a little bit here in just a minute and tell us more about the Cassini mission.
Hello, my name is Greg Ojikengas. I'm a planetary scientist here at Drury. My doctorate is from California Institute of Technology in the planetary science division there. I spent a lot of time studying the moons of Jupiter and their orbits and how they, and moons of the outer solar system, how they warm up and cool down and had a postdoc at the University of Arizona in formation of the solar system. I'm fascinated by the Cassini mission. I've been waiting for it for about 20 years, and it's an amazing place. I'm particularly interested in a small moon that I've spent a lot of time studying in my own research endeavors, and that is Enceladus, a small icy moon about the size of the state of Missouri, made apparently virtually entirely out of ice, about the brightest object in the entire solar system, a ball of ice. And it is in one of a set of amazing is what we call a orbit-orbit resonance. Enceladus orbits Saturn almost exactly twice every time Dione orbits Saturn once. Dione is a bit farther out in a larger moon. And what this does is it causes the tides in the solid rock of Enceladus, the solid ice, I should say, that causes the volcanoes on Io. But there's been a mystery as to how Enceladus is able to produce volcanic activity, ice volcanoes, which have recently been discovered in that process of erupting on Enceladus. And what I'm fascinated with is the possibility that Enceladus may be actually a pile of rubble, a bunch of blocks of ice that have been blown apart by repeated collisions with other planetary bodies early in the history of the solar system. And what we have is probably a pile of rubble that settled down into a sphere. And when tides, the forces of tides apply to Enceladus, the blocks rub together. Just like when you rub your hands together on a cold day to warm them up, the space between the blocks may warm up and produce volcanic activity. This happens at something like 100 degrees below zero Celsius, a few hundred degrees below zero Fahrenheit. So this amazing moon, which clearly has evidence of volcanic activity on its surface. When we look at a moon like Enceladus and we see very few craters in some places, that means that something has oozed out and covered it up. And the amazing thing is that Enceladus probably is volcanically, well, we know now for a fact that it's volcanically active today, supplying the particles of the mysterious E-ring.
Stardust is a mission that is coming back to Earth, and by the time we talk about it in lecture, it will have returned back to Earth or is returning back to Earth very, very soon. Stardust flew through the coma of a comet, which is the atmosphere glowing around the comet. Vilt 2 is spelled W-I-L-D 2. It looks like wild 2, but it's pronounced Vilt 2. Now, Stardust was comprised of various instruments, but the main one is called the aerogel collector. Aerogel is the world's lightest solid. It's 99% plus percentage made up of air and silica, and it is comprised of the most world's lightest solid. It's a very neat substance, and I actually have two samples of it at home. And the samples, which you'll see on the websites, look kind of like blue smoke. These samples of aerogel were to collect pieces of the comet, and on the other side of the aerogel collector were to collect pieces of interstellar dust to see what was out in outer space. It would enclose it into a capsule, return it to Earth, and then return to the Utah desert to be collected and see what the samples look like. Hopefully everything has worked perfectly well. We'll find out very, very soon.
Stardust is out to answer very, very key questions about the formation of the solar system and the formation of Earth. It's believed that comets have brought the water to Earth and a lot of the chemical building blocks that we're comprised of.
3, 2, we have main engine start, 0, and liftoff of the Stardust.
It launched in 1999. 2 years later, in 2001, it flew by the Earth. And as we flew by the Earth, we had used the tug of the Earth's gravity to throw us further out into the solar system. That allowed us to go out to the orbit of the comet Vilt 2.
Well, the comet counter was tremendously exciting. The biggest problem was that we are a sample collection mission, and we wanted to collect a large number of very small particles. But we did not want to get hit by a big enough particle to destroy the spacecraft. Plus, comets are surrounded by a coma of gas and dust, a smog, that prevents you from seeing it. And so we didn't even know where it was precisely until we used our onboard cameras to measure its positions.
In all station starter systems, this is the closest approach at this time.
No spacecraft has flown by so close to a comet and survived perfectly.
The flyby was a fabulous success, and we were stunned by the data from the instruments on board and the pictures.
This is where we collected these tremendously exciting images, And we collected all those thousands and thousands of dust particles that we're bringing back to Earth.
Why we should really care is that we are going to this comet to collect preserved samples of the building blocks of our solar system, our planet, and even ourselves. Those samples have come to us in the form of comet samples. We've grabbed them and they're on the way home, and they'll arrive on January 15th.
Okay, everybody, I have an update for you on Stardust. It did successfully land in the Utah Salt Flats on January 15th in the early morning hours. It's now being analyzed in Houston, Texas, and we can look at the website for the updates on this exciting mission. We met Dr. Greg Ojikangas before when he talked about the Cassini mission and one of its moons. Here he is again now to talk to you about some of the Mars rover missions, Spirit and Opportunity.
Hello again, I am Greg Ojikangas, a planetary scientist here at Drury University, and a geologist as well. And so I am here to talk at this moment about the Mars exploration rovers, which are robotic geologists that have been driving about on the surface of the planet Mars for nearly 2 years, performing many of the acts that a real live geologist would dream of doing on another planetary body. Mars is an amazing planet that is, in many ways, the most Earth-like, and therefore perhaps the most fascinating planet for us to study. It has many of the features of the Earth, and perhaps shares a similar history. And that's what's particularly fascinating about the about what the Mars exploration rovers have been.
Well, we're here on Circe, a wonderful microcosm of geologic environments here on Earth, to learn how to explore the planet Mars. And in this wonderful natural laboratory, we can take stock of the many geologic environments we expect to learn and explore on the planet Mars. We've come all the way, 50 kilometers from the nearest land, the island of Iceland, to explore Mars on Earth, a natural laboratory, basically a scientific oasis for how to understand the Mars that we will be exploring with our Mars exploration rovers. Here on Little Circe, we have all the ingredients that we're looking for as we explore Mars. Volcanoes, water, the interaction of them, unique sedimentary processes, all this in one little place. This is science at its best, and we're here to conduct overland exploration. And I, for one, am so excited I got to get started. So we're off to explore the real Circe, Mars on Earth. On Circe, we're struck by how much like the Mars of our mind's eye that we see. The volcanic rocks, their arrangement on the ground, the lay of the land, the swales and the slopes, the patterns of the sediments that were laid down by a volcano. This is the way we imagine the Mars, and we're looking for that. In fact, as I look around, I can see many of the processes that we're anticipating to be exploring with our Mars rovers. Just here, a rock made by the action of volcanoes and sediments can knock off a piece and see right here what this rock is like. Here is the kind of stuff where water and lava interacted to make the kind of rocks we're looking for on Mars. Doesn't get any better than this here on Circe. I mean, look at this. Here is debris flow city, as you'd say. This is what we're seeing on Mars at the same scale. And here it is in Iceland. We're looking at the toes of debris that have run out of gas just due to the amount of energy and water involved in the system. Layers of sedimentary materials made by volcanoes, the action of water slowly, inexorably tearing them down, eroding them, forming these beautiful gullies. These are fresh landforms, the likes of which we see today on Mars as we see them today on Circe. So here we are on a special kind of plane here on Circe. It reminds us of some of the things we're looking for on Mars where it's windy, just like here, in fact, probably windier than here on Surtsey, known as Meridiani, where we expect to see layers of rocks arranged in a pavement, not unlike this. Rocks embedded in the pavement, and maybe, just maybe, minerals lying on the surface that will tell us that water once sat on Mars and made the minerals in the rocks, just like the water that was recently here did on Surtsey. And look at it. We see of an extremely smooth surface, and it preserves rocks that are stuck in the matrix. Here's a rock that's been eroded out of this very smooth. So here on this windy spot on Surtsey, we have yet another little analog to one of the things we're looking for to understand on the planet Mars. And now we're moving into the erosional gullies of the foreland of Surtsey, where the water has erupted to produce river channels layered by clays, covered with gravels, showing us the stratigraphy of the island. This is the skeleton of Surtsey. We're looking for layers on Mars because they tell a story of the assembly of the rocks. And in that story, when there's water, there's a possibility of records of environments. So it's possible that in Meridiani, we will see layers around the pavements that will tell us a story not unlike this. Now here on Surtsey, we have a spectacular story right here in these layers where the island was constructed explosively. And here's the contact where that island formed an initial surface and then it rained down ash, making all these beautiful layers. This is the kind of stuff we'd love to find on Mars. Warm, wet ashes, making landscapes and preserving their record right up here in the rocks, in these little gravels. That's why we come here, to figure out the clues to Mars. And just at this little scale of my foot, if you can look down, you can see a micro river channel system. This, at the scale of a human being, at a rover scale, tells us the complete story. The water ran, it carved the clays, it carved the canyon, carved the gully at the beginning, and now it shows its river course. This was wet yesterday. And someday on Mars, we'll send rovers up into canyons like this, in gully places, to look for the clues in the Mars rocks. Here we are exploring the volcanic sedimentary terrains that may resemble the Meridiani site, and look what we found. Perhaps the kind of holy grail we're looking on Mars. This is a natural steam vent, a fissure steam vent system that's making sediments. This kind of system on Mars would be the penultimate. These steam vents here on Surtsey are modern testaments to the processes that may have made the hematite that coats the Meridiani site. It coats the surfaces here. You can see some of these red stains are oxides of iron and actually calcite here on Surtsey. This would be the kind of thing we'd love to find, even a fossil version of this at the Meridiani site. Our opportunity site for that rover would be the greatest discovery on Mars in the present lifetime. So here on Surtsey, we have the microcosm, the volcanic sediments, the steam vents all together in one little place, the scale of a human being, the scale of a rover. So we can study them. And here you can see the beginnings of growing algae, moss, favoring this kind of warm, wet environment. That's those kind of environments in the record books of Mars are what we want to understand. So the power of the analogy, seeing Mars on Earth here at Surtsey, and then looking for the Earth on Mars on that distant red planet, trying to experience what it might have been. This is our destiny. This is why coming to Surtsey is so unbelievably exciting to me, feeling as if I'm on Mars.
Here we have a globe of the surface of Mars, color-coded by altitude. And you can see that the northern hemisphere of Mars is darker, is a bluish color, which means it's lower in altitude. The northern hemisphere of Mars may at one time have been covered by what's often called the boreal ocean, basically an ocean similar to those that we have on the Earth now. Of course, it's gone at the present time, but may have existed in the past. There may have been enormous amounts of water on the surface. There probably was on the surface of Mars. The Mars exploration rovers have discovered indisputable evidence of this, and I find that particularly fascinating, of course, because of probably the biggest question in scientific study, at least in astronomy, is there or has there been life on other planets, or are we alone in the universe? And Mars is a nearby planet that may in fact have had living things on its surface, or living creatures on it in the past, and perhaps it even does today below the surface, much like the Earth still has living things, organisms beneath the surface, living in the pore spaces of the rock. So it's a fascinating planet. The exploration rovers have found evidence that water did flow on the surface, and it evaporated, much like the Great Salt Lake is evaporating today. And evidence of iron oxide, which I find particularly fascinating as a geologist, because this iron oxide or hematite is on the Earth was caused by plants approximately 2 billion years ago, beginning to infuse the atmosphere with enough oxygen so that the iron precipitated out of the water in the form of what we now call iron formation. And the surface of Mars, at least on the side that the Opportunity rover is exploring, is covered with iron oxide, and I find it, you know, particularly fascinating to think that perhaps that was related, that precipitation of iron oxide was related to oxygen, perhaps produced by plants at some time in the past. And that's one, just a little of what I find fascinating about the Mars exploration rovers and what they're discovering as we speak on the surface of Mars.
Launch on this project was a lot tougher than I ever expected it to be. Getting to Mars, flying a mission to Mars, is hard. I didn't think that just getting off the ground was going to be the challenge that it actually turned out to be.
You know, the launch is inherently a risky activity. It's one of the higher risk portions of the mission. On top of that, we had some late-breaking changes and repairs we had to make to the spacecraft.
A couple of months before we launched, we blew a fuse on the Spirit spacecraft. Then in the process of evaluating the fuse problem, we found what could have been a very serious flaw in the design of the system on board the spacecraft that fires pyrotechnic devices. And that really had us scared. And there was a lot of work that we needed to do to clear those problems out of the way. And that took us up until really just a few days before it was time to launch. The other thing that slowed us down on Spirit was the weather. That was a daytime launch. In fact, it launched around 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and 2 in the afternoon is, at that time of year in Florida, when thunderstorms come through.
We eventually launched on June 10th, which was basically 12 days into the period. And as a result, we were really under pressure to get Opportunity ready to go.
We tried to launch one night. It was stormy, thunderstorms, lightning out over the Atlantic, and then there was a fishing boat out there. And of course, if you have rockets taking off and dropping solid rocket motors into the ocean, you don't want them landing on fishing boats. So both the weather and the fishing boats would have stopped us that first night. What then happened was we started to run into problems with some thermal insulation on the outside of the rocket.
When we went back to inspect the launch vehicle, you know, you load liquid oxygen and then you have to unload it. We do an inspection. There's cork insulation on the launch vehicle, and it had begun to kind of peel away from the underlying structure.
And so they had to go in there, repair the cork, replace it, until they felt that they had that problem under control. Once that was taken care of, off we went.
From a navigator's perspective, the most difficult challenge of getting to Mars is hitting a target at the top of the atmosphere, such that you will land precisely where you want to on the ground. Hitting a target this small is like trying to thread a needle from 15 miles away. Imagine how difficult it is to thread a needle from just this close. Now imagine that we have to start 15 miles back, and we only get 6 opportunities to change our position while trying to thread this needle.
Between launch from Earth and arrival at Mars, we have opportunities for 6 trajectory correction maneuvers, also referred to as TCMs. The first few are really to correct for the trajectory departing the Earth, and the last few, the last 3, trajectory correction maneuvers 4, 5, and 6, are really to fine-tune the flight paths to hit the desired target at Mars. So when we do the last nominal trajectory correction maneuver, the spacecraft is approaching Mars, and Mars is also moving through space. So we have the spacecraft moving at about 50,000 miles per hour, and Mars is actually overtaking the spacecraft. It's going faster, about 55,000 miles per hour. So we're trying to hit a target on Mars when we're moving and Mars is moving and Mars is approaching us very fast. So it's a very difficult problem. I mean, we thought things were very busy before launch, but after launch things got much more intense. It's just constant activity and there's no time to stop and take a breather. So at the last nominal maneuver, which is called trajectory correction maneuver number 5, we're still at a distance from Mars that's about 500,000 kilometers, which is about 300,000 miles. So hitting that target from that great a distance is like kicking a really long field goal. If you think of a football game, it's like kicking a field goal from Boston to Philadelphia.
EDL, that stands for entry, descent, and landing. But its main job is to take a vehicle that is streaking across interplanetary space. These speeds that our spacecraft travel are just tremendous, and get those speeds down to practically zero on the surface of Mars. We have a heat shield, we have a parachute, we have rockets and an airbag. And we have to use all those elements and very quickly and get it all done in 6 terrifying minutes.
Everything we do in EDL is decided by the computer. We have different sensors that trigger different things, and there isn't time to call back and say, hey, the winds are higher than we expected, or you know what, I'm gonna hit a big pointy rock that's gonna hurt these airbags. It's all about autonomy. I think that's probably, in my mind, the most challenging part. It's just lack of control.
The spacecraft hits the atmosphere of Mars at 12,000 miles an hour. That's time zero for our entry, descent, and landing sequence.
When we hit the top of the Martian atmosphere, we're moving at a speed of 25 times the speed of sound. That's like 20 times faster than a speeding bullet.
And that atmosphere is thick enough that it's going to turn the front end of that heat shield about as hot as the surface of the sun.
Hot gases have enveloped the spacecraft, and the outside skin of the heat shield will reach a temperature of 1600 degrees Celsius. This lasts for 30 seconds.
There's a huge temperature difference from the inside and the outside of the heat shield. The vehicle on the outside is getting thousands of degrees centigrade, while the inside may get up to barely room temperature.
We go through what's called the heat and deceleration pulses. As it slows down through the supersonic speeds and approaches Mach 2, we open a parachute. We're going now about 1,000 miles an hour.
So that parachute comes out, it really slows the vehicle down really fast, and it brings us from going almost sideways to bringing the whole vehicle almost vertical.
The Mars surface is rapidly approaching. We're still moving now about 250 miles an hour.
20 seconds after we deploy the parachute, the spacecraft has slowed to subsonic. In other words, at this time it's moving slower than the speed of sound. At that point in time, we jettison the heat shield.
And then 15 seconds after that, the lander pops out and rappels down a 20 meter long bridle, a rope.
So what happens is while the lander is being lowered from the back shell,
the whole spacecraft is hanging on this cord here. And it's really about the size of a shoelace. It's not much thicker than that. So when that's done, we've got this really neat system. We've got the parachute on top, the back shell in the middle with the retro rockets, and the lander down below.
At this point in time, the radar will have acquired the surface. It'll be in lock with the surface.
And once it sees the ground with the radar, it figures out how fast it's going and how high it is. From that, it can do the math to figure out how long the rockets need to be on.
We added very late in the project a descent imager. It's a camera that takes three pictures and compares high contrast items in those pictures to try to determine the horizontal velocity at which we're moving across the surface to help decide which transverse rockets we're going to fire.
At this point in time, we have to fire the retro rockets or we're going to slam right into the ground.
And just about 5 seconds before we hit the surface of Mars, we inflate the airbags in the lander, then we light the retro rockets. The retro rockets bring the whole system from about 150 miles an hour down to zero, about 15, 20 meters off the surface.
And then we cut the bridle, and the airbag falls the final distance to the surface.
Net velocity when we land is about 20, 24 meters per second when we hit the surface. We hit hard, we bounce high.
Smack, the first impact, 40 Gs. We bounce just as high as we fell from, and then smack again, nearly 40 Gs.
It could kill it right there. The first bounce, if the rocks are in the right formation, if you hit the bags in the right way, our system isn't bulletproof. It has Achilles heels, and if the rocks want to find those, they can.
And then bam, again and again and again, some 15 to 30 impacts, each slightly smaller than the previous one, until finally we end our last minute in this rolling, bouncing rollout that terminates with lander sitting quiet at 0 miles an hour on the surface of Mars. And that's it. MER has landed. EDL is complete.
This is the first time ever that we've had a very sophisticated golf cart-like spacecraft, which is basically put into a cocoon, jammed inside the aeroshell when it goes through the Martian atmosphere, and it has to basically, like a butterfly, go through its metamorphosis before it can do the job for which it was designed.
Normally when you go off and try and design a spacecraft, you try and avoid things like deployments. You know, avoid deployments, avoid motors and actuators. Avoid too many pyro devices, you know. We have all of those things that you would normally just try and avoid in the design of your spacecraft, because we have to.
It has to be folded up in a kind of a robotic origami. The wheels in front have to be folded in on themselves. The back wheels have to be pulled in. The solar arrays have to be nested up. The high gain antenna and the pan cam mast that you see on here all has to be kind of nested into a very, very compact shape. It is definitely 20 pounds of stuff in a 5-pound bag.
There's a lot that has to happen in the impact to egress phase. In the first day, we fire almost 50 pyros and get the spacecraft reconfiguring. There's the airbag retraction, there's the lander pedal deployment, there's the solar array deployment, there's reconfiguring the power bus, there's getting us into a configuration where the rover is ready to receive commands from Earth. And then at that point, we're in a state where we're collecting data, taking images, and transmitting it to Earth. That's the first day.
There's a combined 36 to 40 actuators that have to do their job. There's tens of pyrotechnic devices that have to do their job, and every one of those things has to be verified in sequence in order for us to feel comfortable with driving the vehicle off onto the surface.
If the airbags don't retract, we could potentially catch the lander when we try to deploy it. If the lander pedals don't open, the rover itself is trapped inside the lander and can't deploy its solar panels. If the solar panels don't deploy, we don't have any power to charge our batteries, which is our only source of power on the surface. So if any one of these doesn't happen, it's a bad day on Mars.
So the second day after the first night where it gets power is it has to make sure that it has good communications with the Earth.
We also can only talk to the Earth when we can see it from Mars. You can think about the sun rising and setting on Earth. Well, the Earth rises and sets on Mars, and we can only see and talk to the Earth when it's above the horizon.
After that, the rover must then stand up, which means it has to get all of its wheels, which are bent down like this, plunged out in all directions, and it has six of them. And then it must get away from the lander, and then takes a few pictures to see where it is, and then finally, checking all of its systems to make sure it's okay, it has to say, all right, I'm ready to be on my own. My next thing I have to do is I have to cut all of my electrical connections to the lander. This is a big moment. This is a birth, in truth, because from that moment on, the rover is completely on its own.
If you look at this pocket sitting here, you'll notice that it looks suspiciously like a wheel. And you'll also notice if we grab a wheel, that the wheel will sit very nicely in it. And these are pockets that were deliberately put in because we had to accommodate this wheel sticking outside of this tetrahedron. And these very same pockets and pockets like it are things that we have to be able to drive over and not get caught in. Now these ramps, what they do for us is they give us three different ways we can get off of this lander. The reason that they're needed is because when we do land on airbags and in the uncertain terrain, we can end up at tilts, so that the entire lander is tilted to the side. We can have it pitched up forward. We can have a combination thereof. So what these ramps are doing for us is they're giving us the capability to go off in different directions and handle terrain that we don't really know is going to be there until we get there.
It might take as many as 10 days to get safely onto the surface. Or if we run into big problems, it could take as long as we need to. It's a process that we don't rush, and we do what's necessary when it's necessary, and we make no risks doing it.
That whole process, which is an exciting week right after landing, is called impact to egress. First time it's ever been done, and based on my experience, it's the most complicated and fascinating engineering sequence ever done on a robotic mission.
Good morning, I'm Byron Jones, and this is the Flight Director Report for Thursday, February 2nd. It's been a while since we've had an update, and since then we've had a few great milestones. On January 3rd, we celebrated Spirit's second anniversary of her landing, and on January 24th, we celebrated Opportunity's second anniversary for her landing. Well, that's it for today. I'm Byron Jones, and that's what's happening on Mars today.
The Hubble Space Telescope is an unmanned robotic telescope in low Earth orbit and was named after Edwin Hubble, who was born just a few miles away from Springfield, Missouri and Drury University near Marshfield, Missouri in exit 100 on Interstate I-44. Edwin Hubble was the first to discover that certain galaxies were actually farther away from the Milky Way galaxy, and then discovered that galaxies were expanding away from the Milky Way at receding and expanding speeds faster and faster and faster. He came up with a classification scheme for galaxies, and in his honor, NASA named their space telescope the Hubble Space Telescope.
Galaxies are like islands in the sea of space. They glow with the light of billions of suns. The Hubble telescope reveals nearby galaxies in exquisite detail. Galaxies like these fill the universe. Looking deep into space, we see an astonishing array of distant galaxies. It takes billions of years for their light to reach us. We see them not as they are, but as they once were. In one tiny region of the sky, Hubble finds some 30,000 galaxies. Within a single image, we can explore 10 billion years of cosmic history. relatively nearby galaxies are fully formed, with complete spiral structures and smooth elliptical shapes. As we travel farther into space, we see galaxies as they were further back in time. These galaxies appear somewhat disheveled, their mature structures still developing. When the universe was young, newly formed galactic disks were ablaze with star formation. Beyond this point, clumps of stars that are beginning to form galaxies. We've seen but a handful of the billions of galaxies stretched across space and time. Just one small sliver of the universe, observed by Hubble.
Marshfield, in his honor, have put on their town square a 1/3 scale size replica of the Hubble Space Telescope. I will show you here some pictures of the replica space telescope. And along Interstate I-44, if you're from the Springfield, Marshfield area or Lebanon area, you probably have seen pictures alongside the roadside of the Evan P. Hubble Memorial Highway and signs saying, "Come see our replica of the Hubble Space Telescope." Well, if you don't live around this area, I'm going to show you right now those pictures. The Hubble Space Telescope was launched in 1990 by the space shuttle. Evan Hubble was born right here in Marshfield, Missouri, just about 25 miles up the road of I-44 from Drury University in Springfield, Missouri. Here in Marshfield, Missouri, they're very proud of their homeborn son. And throughout this DVD, you'll see pictures and interviews of people who knew him. You'll see artifacts of Evan Hubble, and you'll see newspaper clippings of Evan Hubble. We'll see some historical artifacts of Hubble. We'll visit the courthouse, and we'll visit the Historical Society, and try to interview some of the people that knew Evan Hubble. Edwin Hubble's legacy is shown all around the city of Marshfield from this picture on the side of a building, all the way to the busy intersection of Hubble Drive in Marshfield. They've even named a school, an elementary school, after Dr. Edwin Hubble.
Well, I'm Gladys James George, and I'm a related Edwin Hubble. My father was a distant cousin of his, and well, he wasn't a distant cousin, now. It'd be about second or third cousins. And only I remember seeing him when I was a child. He came out to the Hubble Ranch where we lived. And my father told my sister and I to get up our pony so he could ride the pony. And he got on our pony backwards. And I thought that was awful dumb of him. But I guess later on I decided that he was teasing us kids. And from there he went back town, and he walked, well, he'd been to college in England, And I understand he walked a long ways out of Marshfield to a place out in the country he wanted to see. And he was just a wonderful athlete, I think, in his young days, the way I understand it. And we all went, my sisters and two of their sisters' husbands as long. We went to Florida to see the launching of the telescope. And we were there, we stayed in a motel that was recommended by the people taking care of these Hubble relation. And we stayed there almost 2 weeks and had to come home. But on account of the weather, they didn't launch it at that time. But in fact, we were all, they furnished us a bus, and we were on a bus going out to the launching when they discontinued it at the time.
My name's Jack J. Hubble. I was born and raised in Webster County, Missouri, and I'm a distant cousin of Dr. Edwin Powell Hubble, the famous astronomer. A couple of the stories that come to mind that I have thought was probably the most important to me over the years was one, when Dr. Powell was about to make his discovery, he had what he thought was evidence that the universe was expanding. Before he made that public, he had sent notes to Albert Einstein suggesting what he'd found. And Dr. Einstein laughed him off and even slightly ridiculed him over even the suggestion. Well, years later, months later, when Dr. Powell gave him the formula and the evidence, and the entire scientific community got behind Dr. Edwin Powell, Einstein made the statement that it was the biggest mistake he'd ever made in his life. That has stuck in my mind as one of the high points of Edwin Powell Hubble's life. You know, Edwin Powell was also very athletic. He was 6'4" tall, was a high jumper, a track star, among his other work. The other thing that sticks in my mind is I belong to the Hubble Family Historical Society, and for years we chased trying to find out where Edwin Powell was buried. And finally, after a number of years, when we searched cemetery records, you know, through the state of California and other states, we finally found out that he actually was cremated at his own request, and his ashes were dusted in the San Diego Bay, as was later his wife's. The other things about Edwin Powell is, you know, it just, I was instrumental in helping the Webster County Historical Society build a replica of the Hubble Space Telescope on their public square, which is the county seat of Webster County, Missouri. And I also worked with a couple of politicians, representative and a state senator, as well as the Webster County Historical Society, and getting a 10-mile stretch of Interstate 44 renamed the Edwin Powell Hubble Memorial Highway. For this, I was thankful because it means that Edwin Powell will be remembered for years to come.
The last mission we'll talk about in this class is the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter. Launched in August of 2005, this orbiter will be able to take pictures the size of this beach ball. It is a very important mission to NASA. It will be able to take images very, very small and have very high resolution to it. It's a very new mission. It'll be the newest mission in NASA's fleet to Mars. It has at this time not yet gotten to Mars, but will be reaching there very shortly during this class. So this will be a very dynamic mission. You'll see and learn lots about it. We'll see if it succeeds or fails in getting to Mars. Remember that 50% or more of all missions to Mars fail. So we'll see if this mission actually gets there and succeeds in getting into orbit and how it works. Welcome to Mars. We hope.
Spirit and opportunity are one element of a much larger program of exploring Mars.
The two Mars exploration rovers and the MGS and all these missions that are now orbiting Mars right now, they really are just setting the stage for the next phase of our exploration. As you know, in the next phase, we plan to send three additional missions to go to Mars.
We have a mission, the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, that is just a few weeks away from going into Mars orbit.
We'll be firing our main engine to slow the spacecraft down so that the spacecraft can be captured by the planet. But as the spacecraft is slowed down, a part of that engine burn process is occurring behind the planet. We cannot see it. We cannot listen to it until it comes out on the other side. All this thing has to be done with a high level of precision. If we don't do it right, we may not be able to be captured. And if we do it wrong, we can also dip too much into the atmosphere of Mars and get burned up. And there will be this fraction of time that we will not be able to see what's going on. And that's why I consider it to be extremely challenging and exciting to watch what would actually happen on that day.
We'll be seeing images of a resolution which is much smaller than 1 meter, on the order of about a foot, actually. And those observations will provide us better insight into the processes that are at work today and in the past.
Well, some breaking news now for the New Horizons mission going to Pluto, the last planet to be explored by robotic spacecraft in our solar system. It was launched on January 19th of 2006. It's going to be traveling at an amazing speed of 10 miles per second. That equates to about 39,000 miles per hour at its fastest speed. And at that speed, it'll take about 9 years to get there. Now, when it gets to Pluto, it will actually take science measurements for about 36 hours at Pluto and its moon Charon, and then go on to the Kuiper Belt for a 5 to 6 year mission and go on beyond there. Well, that's it for the class. It's now time to take your final. The final will be over the missions we've talked about that are currently going on since the midterm. I really hope you've enjoyed the class and you'll do your evaluations for the class. Remember, you'll get 5 bonus points for doing the evaluations. I really enjoyed teaching this class to you with this new format, with the video technology. This is the second time I've taught this course. I really enjoy the subject, and I hope you enjoyed learning about the space missions. In the summer, I offer a manned space flight class, and I hope you'll consider taking that class too. For now, thank you, and good luck to you on the final. Hope to see you on other online classes here at Drury University. So long for now.